I've been asked to talk about the issue of scripture interpretation in the early church. And there are a variety of ways to deal with it, but I thought I would approach some of the most basic issues rather than just the tensions between Alexandria and Antioch and interpretation. That would be a good topic, but maybe not this time, some other time. I'd like to talk about the most basic issues that come from the very question of the existence of a scripture. We take it for granted. But why? Did the pagans have such? Did the pagans have books that they looked to as scripture? You have some, perhaps, analogy to it in Babylon, because every New Year's festival, they would read out loud in public the Enuma Elish, their creation story. And then they had a little dramatization where the high priest would slap the king in the face, just to remind him that since the gods had created everybody to be a slave, he was a slave too. But I'm sure he didn't hit him too hard because the festival was only 3 days. So he had to live with the king after that. But apart from that, you see mention of stories of the pagan gods, but even they were not treated as scripture because many of them, for instance, Ovid, is writing them down at the period in which these stories are beginning to fade away in importance. So the idea of a scripture is very odd. And even in Egypt, you don't see the Book of the Dead so much as a scripture, as an aid to help you in the world of the dead. When you died, you had to know the right answers to give. But that was about it. It wasn't scripture that you studied during life as a way to base your life on. And they didn't have a Ten Commandments or things like this. So this idea of a scripture is something that has a distinctive element within ancient Israel. They have books that they look to, and we see these books cited frequently within the Bible itself. You see, the prophets are making reference to the commandments. Now remember, they did not have chapters and verses yet. Those are Christian inventions. The chapters were put in by an 11th century English monk. And the verses were not put in until Gutenberg began printing the Bible to make sure he didn't skip any. That was a very practical reason. But they would make reference and allusion to the Old Testament, the Torah especially, the first five books. You see that in prophets like Hosea and the others. Ezekiel, in very strong ways, makes a lot of references to the writings of the Old Testament, of the Torah. But also in the books of Joshua through Kings, you see references to the book of Deuteronomy. So these already are the beginnings of looking at a scripture as an authoritative text by which you interpret life. This is something distinctive. And another element that we see is not only is the Old Testament quoted within the Old Testament, the Torah being quoted by the prophets, and sometimes we even find the prophets being quoted by the prophets. So the famous hymn in Isaiah 2 and Micah 4 about Jerusalem is repeated. Nobody knows who wrote it first, but you see them quoting this. And we see allusions to the book of Psalms within the prophets. So that the book of Psalms also has a certain kind of authority as scripture and is used in prophetic texts, especially by Jeremiah, himself a priest, therefore someone who would be familiar with the Psalter because it was the official prayer book of the temple. And then Israel returns from exile. And this fulfills prophecy, doesn't it? The prophets had said you would go off to exile and you will come back. And God will restore you. This gave the scripture, including the prophets, great authority because what they said happened. There's nothing like having a prophecy fulfilled to give it great credibility. So this augmented the authority of the prophets. But we also see that by the time of the prophet Malachi, already there is a certain kind of decline in the religious culture. People are becoming lax. Malachi is writing somewhere in the 460s, maybe 470s BC. And as a result, Nehemiah and Ezra come from Persia to Judea, and they start a reform. And one of the most remarkable elements of the reform that they begin is the reading of the Torah out loud and in public as a way to give guidance to the reform. But it's not only that they read it. Something remarkable goes along with it that is going to start a change within Israel that affects us to this day. They read the Torah in public, in Jerusalem, for all the people to hear, but the people were already forgetting how to speak and understand Hebrew. And so there were priests there listening who would translate it into Aramaic for the folks to understand, because at this time, Aramaic was well established as an international language. It had been used as an international language by the Babylonians, but was really used and institutionalized as an international language by the Persians, because it was so easy to read compared to Persian or Babylonian. Their language had about 385 letters in the alphabet. Aramaic had 22. That's simple. Anybody can learn to read that. So that's why it became so international. It was a simple language. And this is why the returning Judeans spoke Aramaic. And they'd forgotten Hebrew when they were in the exile. And it's close. It's a related language, but it's also different. And you hear it, you say, oh, that's not quite the same. So this translation of the Torah into Aramaic is, you know, we read in the Bible, no big deal, but you don't see that happen for anybody else's religion. And later on, when the Persian Empire is defeated, 130 years later, and Greek replaces the Persian Empire, the Hellenistic Empire replaces it, and Greek begins to become the international language, we see that the Jews take the next logical step, and around 250, under Ptolemy IV Philadelphus, they translate the Torah into Greek. And over the next 150 years or so, they finished translating the rest of the Bible into Greek. It was a long process. The Torah was what we would call the original Septuagint. They translated that first. But then they began to translate all the other books, which again indicates that these are all being treated as scripture. It's remarkable. That you have to, because when you translate from one language to another, you also are giving an interpretation. You don't translate word for word so easily. Otherwise, you sound like my grandparents from Poland. They come to this country, they don't talk it so good. She's got them go like this. And we picked up on some of it too, obviously. But there would be a lot of idioms that we translate literally from Polish. Pojedę przedomu mojego kolega. I'm going to go by my friend's house. Whereas in English, you don't say you're going by the house. If you go by, you keep just going right by. But in Polish, that's good Polish. In English, that's bad English. That's why you don't translate literally, word for word. Because languages have different nuances. So you just say, I'm going to my friend's house in English. That's good English. But I had no idea that until I was in college. Because everybody in my neighborhood talked like that. All our grandparents came from the old country. So this is something that is important to understand about translation. The Bible is translated into Greek. And then in the first century BC, a written translation into Aramaic, the Targum, is made. Again, a remarkable phenomenon that you translate a scripture from one language into another. These are the very first translations of religious books from one language to another in their entirety in the history of the world. That's how astounding this is, and we take it for granted. And we do this, but we shouldn't take it for granted. You see the ancient mentality still present among Muslims, for whom you can only read the Quran correctly in Arabic. Even if you don't understand what it means, you still have to read it in Arabic. And everything else is a mere interpretation. So I have a bilingual Quran, and it says the Quran and its meaning. The translation is just the meaning of it, but it's not the Quran. Only the Arabic. And your prayers in Islam are only acceptable if you pray in Arabic. No matter what language you speak yourself, you can only have God hear you if you pray in Arabic. That would be a much more ancient mentality. The Israelites saw, no, we can translate this. And it still is the Bible, still is the Word of God. This is remarkable and very important. Now, because the Israelites not only were able to translate, they also had to deal with a variety of changing circumstances that required interpretation of the scripture. And this, again, is very important. You don't see this kind of exegetical work and interpretative work among pagans. They didn't do this. And again, we don't want to take Bible interpretation for granted just because it's common to us. Think of it in the context of the ancient world. This is something brand new. And there are a number of ways in which the Bible was interpreted. First of all, I've already mentioned how it's applied. Some of the prophets would say this is being fulfilled and so on. Some of the historical books would say this fulfills this text in the Torah or in the prophets. So already the Bible isn't using the Bible to interpret itself. But also we see that books of the Bible begin to retell the story of the Bible. The book of Sirach is not only 39 chapters of wisdom gathered by Sirach, but it's from chapter 40 onward to 52, it's a retelling of the story of Israel and giving some of the highlights of that story so that a summarized telling of the story of salvation and how God acted in salvation is being used so as to give the truly wise heroes to imitate. But he's doing it in a poetic form, which is, again, an interpretation of the text, which is then read as a scriptural text when it's included in the canon. The Book of Wisdom is also taking material from the Old Testament, especially from the story of Exodus and the wandering in the wilderness, and applying it again to Jews living in Egypt. As a matter of fact, among the Old Testament books, this is one of two books composed in Greek. First Maccabees was translated from Hebrew to Greek. So was Sirach, as his grandfather, his grandson did the translation. He says so in the preface. We've got that. But Second Maccabees and the Book of Wisdom were composed in Greek, both of them in Alexandria. And they give us a window into how they would interpret Scripture, the Old Testament, so as to apply it to what, for them, was modern times. And the modern problem was, as Jews lived in a Gentile context, they began to be attracted to the paganism around them. And so this is a way, in the Book of Wisdom, especially chapters 10 through 20, to show Jewish people, you look at the Old Testament not just as an historical curiosity, but apply it to your life and learn that the ancient Egyptians who worshipped other gods were killed, plagued, they died. Well, the Israelites were saved because they worshiped the one true God. Therefore, be faithful to the revelation. And this also gets included within the canon used by the Jews living in Alexandria. And we also see that in the Book of Wisdom, in addition to trying to get contemporary Jews not to fall into paganism as this becomes more popular. And remember, here's something else that's going on. It's not simply old-time Egyptian paganism. Remember, when Alexander the Great came into Egypt, he allowed himself to be made Pharaoh, not just a king. And as Pharaoh, he was a god. So he allowed himself to be worshipped by the Egyptians. And he and the Ptolemies after him began making new temples that combined Greek ideas, Greek art, and pharaonic religion, Egyptian religion. See, a number of these temples, some of the best preserved temples in Egypt, were built not by the ancient Egyptians, but they were sponsored by the Greek kings, the Ptolemies. And they were also combining Greek philosophy. So the Book of Wisdom is also a reflection on Greek philosophy. Now we'll get to hold on to some of these ideas, because these have come back into play as we deal to early Christianity. There's another very important Jewish figure, Philo of Alexandria, who is dealing with the same problem, but he's someone who lives in the time of Christ. He died in the year 50 AD. And remember, there was one man versed in the scriptures who came to Ephesus, was baptized, and then went to Corinth. Apollos. Remember Apollos? And he's the one that, you know, became a cause celeb in Corinth. Some communities, some house churches said they were with Apollos. Others said they were with Peter. Others said they were with Paul. And Paul had to say, who's Apollos, who's Peter? Well, he's probably a refugee because from the school of Philo of Alexandria, where they taught Greek eloquence, the Greek language, Greek philosophy, and combined it with the Old Testament. Because Jews living in the diaspora had to confront the reality of Greek philosophy. And how do we cope with this? Is sometimes has some pretty good ideas. How do we integrate the Bible with these Greek philosophies? And Philo was continuing really the work of the Book of Wisdom, but did it by exegesis. And that's what's very distinctive. He takes the philosophy, especially from Plato and Socrates and Neoplatonic ideas, and he tries to meld that with Judaism. The Bible is key, but he does exegesis of texts. later on, this kind of approach of exegesis of Scripture begins among Christians in the same city of Alexandria. This is where we see the first Christian exegete. And it's probably influenced by what the Jews were doing in interpreting Scripture as exegesis of texts, but using philosophy. Now, let's then take a look at some of the next step. Because Christianity, almost forgot. One other group of Jews that had to interpret Scripture who become very, very crucial for us in understanding Christian interpretation. That is the Pharisee party. The Pharisee, the word Pharisee comes from Hebrew, perushtim. It means separated ones. They thought of themselves as being separate from those Jews who were trying to combine Judaism with the Greek world. And they thought of themselves, they thought of the Sadducees as having gone too far in accommodating to the Greek culture. The Sadducees were the nobility and the priesthood. The Pharisees were lay people. They were not the priests. They were the laity. It was a lay revivalist movement. And they separated themselves from those Jews who wanted to accommodate to the Greek culture. These Jews were doing things like wearing hats. And they were going to the gymnasium. Yucko. Not just because they're worried about their waist. What was the problem with the gymnasium? Gymnos is the word nude. And that's how they did their sports. Male nudity, well, nudity in general, but especially male nudity, was abhorrent to Jews. And so they hated the idea that there was a gymnasium in Jerusalem. And eventually a horse race track. And a theater. And all this stuff drove the Pharisees crazy. While the Sadducees were accommodating to this. So the Pharisees come up with a couple of ways of interpreting Scripture that are extremely important for understanding the New Testament. One, they say that we have to protect Scripture to make sure we do not break a single law. So much so that the Pharisees believed that if every single Jew would stop sinning for a half hour, just one half, I'll get everybody to stop sinning, then the Messiah could come. Now remember this, whenever you see Christ engaging in disputes with the Jews over the issue of eating with sinners, the sinners are stopping the Messiah. What are you doing? And he's saying, no, it's the sinners that bring down the Messiah. They're the ones that need him. This is a major dispute of interpretation between Pharisees and Jesus and the Christians. But they believed that if there was no sin for a half hour, you'd have the Messiah. So what do? To protect the law from being broken, they had a very important interpretive device that they describe in the Mishnah, which is a collection of rabbinic sayings that goes back to about 135 BC all the way to 200 AD. Over 300 years of interpretation of the Old Testament Torah. And this principle that they used was called putting a fence around Torah. You put a fence around it to make sure that you don't break God's law. We'll put a fence that you don't go over that fence. So make sure you don't even get close to breaking God's law. That was putting a fence around Torah. Now, examples of this, all of you are familiar with. The Torah says, do not cook a kid in its mother's milk. And why would they make such a law? I had to include that verse in my dissertation. And I suspect I'm one of the few writers of Old Testament dissertations who cited one of the local Middle Eastern cookbooks. The reason is, unlike cow's milk, goat's milk does not curdle when you cook it. Ever try to make beef stroganoff and have the sour cream curdle if you turn it up too high? See, there's somebody nodding their head. I did that once too. Tastes okay, but it looks yucky. Well, you can't cook cow's milk too high, it'll curdle. Goat's milk doesn't curdle. That's why they would cook it. And there's a recipe, Laban Immo, the milk of his mother, and that they still use, they still make. Well, to make sure that you don't break that law, don't even have milk and meat in the same meal. Don't cook with the same pots in milk and meat. Don't serve milk and meat in the same dishes. You have this begins the kosher laws for cooking. To make sure you protect that one law, women have to know all these things about what it means to be kosher. And that was a fence, a big fence. To make sure that you don't become cursed by taking God's name in vain, you may not ever say God's name. That's why they don't say the holy name. And so this is the process. And they interpreted the Bible so that when Jesus criticizes their tradition, it's the tradition of the Pharisees by which they were putting this fence around Torah and adding on all these burdens. These were the burdens that he was talking about. But for them, it was the way to protect us so that maybe the Messiah could come. So you see the tension in the communities over this interpretation principle for how you understand Scripture. Now, similar problems of interpreting Scripture occur in the early church. We have to start off. What is the main principle of interpretation for the New Testament and for most of the early church? The basic principle is Jesus Christ of Nazareth, who died and rose from the dead and descended into heaven. This is the basic point. And the Gospels almost certainly begin with that as the core proclamation. Now, we'll get into that problem later, but one of the things that's important about this is when you start off knowing what you want, knowing what your goals are, then you get a better idea of what to remember. You don't just remember anything. People remember based on what their purposes and goals are. So my main purposes and goals in grammar school were not about getting good grades, so I sometimes forgot to do my homework. You know, playing with the guys was, you know, going out to play baseball. That was a little bit more on the forefront. Or reading books I wanted to read was more in the forefront. And so you forget about things that are not taking out the garbage, feeding the dog, walking the dog. A lot of things I forgot. My mother think that I'd have to thank God that my head was attached. Well, this is true in general. We remember based on what our goals are. And so we must take a look at the New Testament as being, especially the Gospels, but the writings of St. Paul and the other apostles in the same way. They are all focused on the death and the resurrection, ascension of Jesus and his second coming as the purpose. And then you remember back. See, this is one of the reasons why it's so inherently dumb to try to psychoanalyze Jesus for any reason by looking at the Gospels. The Gospels are not written in order to give a biography of Jesus. They are all written with the perspective of heading toward the meaning of his death and resurrection. That's the basis. And this is the core interpretive process by which Christians looked at everything sacred. Now, some of the difficulties that came up were interpretations of things like the Old Testament. If Jesus is the center, is the Old Testament scripture for us or not? Is this something that still has validity for us? And they had to work through a very difficult process of trying to understand that, yes, some parts of scripture are to be interpreted by us as still authoritative and other parts not. And one of the things that they especially looked to were the prophecies of the Messiah. They saw Jesus fulfill those. They were truly amazed by how much he fulfilled prophecy. But at the same time, they ran into difficulties. I've already given a little hint of one of the difficulties between the early church and the Pharisees. Two absolutely distinct perspectives on salvation. Both expected the resurrection of the dead. Both believed that the righteous would be raised to glory and the wicked would be raised to damnation. Both believed in the authority of Scripture and God's Word. Both believed in angels and the immortality of the soul, all of which were doctrines that were not accepted by the Sadducees. They did not believe in the resurrection of the dead, angels, or the eternity of the soul. They denied that. So Christians and Pharisees agreed on that. But this issue of making sure that the Torah is protected and we never break it, and that sinlessness sets the condition to allow the Messiah to come, versus the Christian perspective that the Messiah came to redeem sinners. So while they had a lot in common, the Pharisees and the Christians also had a big kind of heads-on fight with each other. So much so that the Pharisees are highly motivated to persecute the church in the 30s. Pontius Pilate had to leave Jerusalem, had to leave the Holy Land, because he had basically sent a bunch of cavalry up to Samaria, and they wiped out a lot of citizens for no reason. They just started killing Samaritans. So he was called to Rome in 36 to explain this. Fortunately for him, the emperor died while he was on the way over. But while he was gone, the Pharisees, along with the help of the Sadducees, instigated the first persecution of the Christians. That's when Paul is trying to kill Christians. That's how deep the opposition became, just within 6 years after the death and resurrection. Then, by 85 AD, so just 50 years later, the Pharisees institute a condemnation of the Christians and excommunicate them from the synagogue. And among the 18 blessings to be said was a cursing of the Christians, called the minyanim, the heretics. So there's this dispute with the Pharisees, and this becomes an important issue, because again, the question of, are we a sect of the Jews, or are we different? And if we're not Jews anymore, or are we Jews, or what? This is causing great tension. And how you interpret the scripture is crucial to that. So that's another issue. Another issue has nothing to do with the Jews in the Holy Land, but has to do with Christianity moving out into the wider world. And just as Philo and the Book of Wisdom had to learn how to interpret the Bible in light of the Greek ideas, the Greek world in which they lived, are we going to be such oddballs that we can't even communicate with our neighbors about philosophy, or are we going to integrate philosophy and Greek ideas into the faith? That's another struggle. So these are some of the issues that come up with Christian interpretation of the scriptures. And then, of course, one last issue is Christians begin writing down a book, a series of books, and that will eventually become a canon. That's the New Testament. What has more authority, the Old Testament or the New Testament? You already see St. Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 4 making reference, excuse me, chapter 3, making reference to the Old Covenant and the New Covenant. And within 130 years, you'll see that the collection of Christian books is called the New Testament. And what's the relationship of that? These are some of the most basic issues of interpretation. And it's important for us to see the stages in which this went. Let me go through those now. First stage is the writing of the New Testament. Second, the sub-apostolic fathers, those who came right after the apostles. Third would be the stage of the apologists in the second century. Then fourth is going to be the stage begun by Saint Irenaeus, where he deals with the question of scripture and tradition. Fifth is going to be the issue of Christology becoming dominant. Sixth is going to be the beginning of Christian exegesis. And seventh is going to be when St. Augustine introduces new issues of what it means to be a human being and a Christian. What's the role of free will, grace, salvation, and how do I experience it? So let's just mention some of these and go through them a little more carefully. The New Testament. The New Testament is where the first, in one sense, battleground, good to talk about in the state of Ohio, huh? Battleground issues. The New Testament is the first battleground where we see the Christians actually dealing with the role of the Old Testament and interpreting it. And again, as I said, their main principle is Jesus Christ. And what they do again and again and again, whether it be in the four Gospels or in most of the epistles, nine epistles do not quote the Old Testament at all. Philippians does not. Colossians does not. A number of others. Jude does not. But most of all the rest of the epistles and the Gospels and Acts of the Apostles frequently quote the Old Testament. 360 times they quote the Old Testament. And the majority of these quotes are to show that Jesus Christ fulfills Old Testament prophecies. That's the key. And they'll quote them, they'll cite them. 300 of those quotes are cited from the Septuagint, that Greek translation, because they were writing in Greek. This is, again, the international language. The other 60 quotes are done by the evangelists, especially in John. You see it in some of the other places. They'll quote, they'll translate themselves. But usually they don't, just like most of us. Most of us don't go back and translate from the New Testament Greek. When we read it, we usually read a translation. That's what they did. And it was a translation they were already familiar with, and they oftentimes quote it more from memory than from writing it down. They don't write it word for word, they copy it, but they quote it from memory. And this is very significant because they don't usually deal with quoting the Old Testament to show that we must obey the Old Testament laws the way the Pharisees would do. There is that. There is a type of quotation by which they quote the Old Testament laws, the Ten Commandments especially. Those are cited repeatedly by Jesus and Paul and the apostles and a variety of circumstances to show that you must obey that law. Also the law, you shall love the Lord your God with your whole heart, your whole mind, and your whole soul. The famous prayer, the Shema Yisrael, that's quoted by Christ. And love your neighbor as yourself, from Leviticus 17, that's quoted. So there are a number of laws that are quoted, and we cannot dismiss it. As a matter of fact, when the rich young man asks Jesus, what must I do to be saved? Jesus quotes the Ten Commandments. So the Old Testament laws are important, but most of the quotes are from the prophetic texts, showing that Jesus is the suffering servant of Isaiah. He's the one born in Bethlehem, as Micah had said. He's the one born of a virgin, as Isaiah 7 says. On and on. He's the one the prophet prophesied in Deuteronomy 18 by Moses. These are the types of quotes that they give. And the Psalms are quoted. They're quoted as especially when they're messianic psalms. Psalm 2 is quoted by God the Father, as is Isaiah 42. This is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased. Listen to him. And Psalm 110 is the most quoted section of scripture in the New Testament. No other passage is quoted nearly as often as Psalm 110. Especially the lines where it said, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand. And secondly, you are a priest according to the order of Melchizedek. These are treated as prophetic texts. Then, they also spend a lot of time rejecting both Pharisee interpretation. We are not going to interpret the Old Testament by putting a fence around the law to make sure that you don't break every single small commandment. That is rejected by Jesus. You see that in Mark 7. And Matthew 15, don't follow the tradition of your fathers, referring to the Pharisees' tradition. But also, Paul especially has to deal with that, not just in terms of the Pharisaic interpretation, but something as basic as the issue of circumcision. And he deals with the issue of circumcising Christians, trying to force circumcision on the Gentile converts. And he says, no, that may not be done. Because what you are doing is going back and taking the sign of the old covenant. And in that wonderful passage in Galatians chapter 3, where he says, there's neither male nor female, slave nor free, Jew nor Gentile, Greek nor barbarian. This is dealing with that issue because obviously women can't be circumcised. And even if you were a slave who became circumcised to convert to Judaism, you were not counted, nor a Gentile, you were not counted as Jewish for three generations. And so here it's saying, no, our sign of the new covenant is baptism. And we reject circumcision, that brings you to the old covenant, and then it forces you to be saved by obeying these laws. He rejects that interpretation. And then we also see in the famous vision of St. Peter that by the authority given from heaven to St. Peter, he says that the kosher laws are no longer applicable. So this two crucial issues of Bible interpretation and saying we don't accept those parts of the Old Testament because we are a New Testament. We are a New Covenant. But we do accept the moral laws. And again, we know how this was a great dispute on how to interpret the Old Testament. Now, you had people going to various extremes because already in the sub-apostolic times, these are the times in which Clement is writing, the letter of Barnabas, Clement of Rome, that is, and St. Ignatius of Antioch. As they write, they're dealing with these issues of interpretation fairly authoritatively. 1 and 2, Clement and Barnabas, are the only sub-apostolic fathers who quote the Old Testament and the New directly, especially the Old Testament. And mostly it's to, in the case of First Clement, to show how God put order into the world, so don't get rid of your priests and bishops and cause disorder. Barnabas quotes it to show that Christianity is superior to Judaism. So don't pay attention to that. We are giving you what's correct. But they use the Old Testament to show that the Old Testament is wrong, much as St. Paul had done when he dealt with the issue in Galatians and Romans. St. Ignatius of Antioch, especially in his letter to the Philadelphians, is warning against those who reject the Old Testament entirely. He already had some who said, no, you don't use the Old Testament. We don't buy any of that stuff at all. And he already had to correct the issue of total rejection of everything in the Old Testament. So you can see that the ferment of the New Testament times continued on to the following generations. Well, after the subapostolic fathers, we have the apologists. Now, these are a very important group. These would be Justin Martyr, Tatian, Athenagoras, Theophilus. These guys are writing in order to explain Christianity mostly to pagans, though, of course, Justin also argues with Trypho, a Jewish man. And so these are attempts to show that not so much arguing Old Testament versus New Testament, except with Trypho, but mostly trying to say Christianity is superior to paganism, and pagans should convert, and also we are not subversive. Remember, Christians were so closely associated with Judaism, and Judaism was a troublemaker religion. They had a famous revolt in 70 AD, another revolt in 132 AD. There were riots in the time of the Emperor Trajan and Alexandria with the Jews. So there are three times in which Jewish people were accused of causing violence, and Christians were associated with the Jews, and therefore they're the troublemakers too. And so the apologists are partly separating themselves from the Jewish community, which at this time was primarily just Pharisees and their disciples. And then comes St. Irenaeus. Now, this is a turning point in history of the church. St. Irenaeus wrote a book called Against the Heresies, Contra Heresies. And in this book, he does a number of things that are absolutely crucial for our identity as a church. First, he's writing against the Gnostics. The Gnostics were various groups who had taken Christian ideas and adapted them with their own scriptures. They had made their own books, and these were found at Nag Hammadi. And the Majnun that wrote that book, the Da Vinci Code, uses these as part of his background. Say, oh, these were the real gospels. Yeah, duh, Vinci is right. These were written at the earliest, the second century, late second century, and into the third century. And that's a very important fact that Irenaeus is going to bring out. Also, how another very important fact, the Gnostics could not agree amongst themselves. If they were getting true gnosis, true knowledge from the spiritual realm, you'd think that the spiritual realm had a kind of unity to it. But they didn't agree on anything amongst themselves. And he brings that out. And the Nag Hammadi texts help us to support his criticisms. Thirdly, the Gnostics also rejected the Old Testament in its entirety. But not only did they reject the Old Testament in its entirety, they rejected the God of the Old Testament. And this becomes extremely important for us because one of them is named Marcion. I got Mother Angelica to do a double take the first time I was on the show with her. back in February 1984. I was going through the history of the canon. And I said, Marcion is a son of a bishop. She said, what? What was she thinking, huh? Whose own father excommunicated him. And his own father, the bishop, did excommunicate him. But he rejected everything Old Testament, everything Jewish, and said that only books written by Gentiles, and St. Paul was a Jew, but he expurgated as part of that. Only St. Paul and St. Luke are the New Testament, and that decision by Marcion forced the church to say, no, the writings of Paul and the four Gospels are scripture. It was not decided by Constantine at the Council of Nicaea, as the Da Vinci Code says. Already in the second century, Marcion forced this. And this all comes into play for St. Irenaeus, because then he says, look, we have to deal with this problem of spreading Gnosticism. And he tackled this error head on. And he said that the issue is that we have a rule of faith. Later on, this is going to be called a tradition. The rule of faith is basically summarized in the creeds. He's already stating the basic principles of the creed. There is one God, not two gods, one of the Old Testament, one of Jesus and the New Testament. That's what Gnostics were saying. That's what Marcion was saying. We believe in one God. Then he says the Father and Jesus Christ, his Son, and the Holy Spirit, who spoke to the prophets. What does that mean? This very basic principle says the Holy Spirit was speaking in the Old Testament. This is scripture, and it has authority for us. But we must understand these Old Testament scriptures in the light of Jesus Christ and the whole of the rule of faith, the tradition. He made a great comparison in book 3 of against the heresies, in which he says, the scriptures are like a mosaic. And you know, mosaic is made out of small, tiny tiles. The rule of faith is what gives it a pattern. Without the rule of faith, the scriptures are just a pile of tiles. Mosaic tiles. You can play with that pun if you want. And with this rule of faith, they form this picture that makes sense out of life. And how do we know this rule of faith? Because we've got the apostolic tradition. The Gnostics do not. The Gnostics have separated themselves and started their own scriptures. They don't use the tradition. And they are all diversified. We in the Catholic Church, as he's already calling it, already been called that by Ignatius of Antioch. We in the ecumenical church have this, and by ecumenical he meant worldwide, as well as Catholic, that we have this rule of faith to make sense out of all the tiles of mosaic and put this into a beautiful picture. And we all see the same picture. For all the diversity that existed in the church, which Irenaeus is well aware of, there's also this unity of faith. And the scriptures are understood in this context. And what do we see? That Jesus of Nazareth, who died and rose again and ascended, is also the Word by whom creation came into being. And Jesus, the Word, is working through all of human history. And he is the key to the economy of salvation that God has given us. And here's a way to understand it. Now, he posed problems that arise in the 2nd, 3rd, 4th, and 5th centuries. He's the one who sets the stage for the next step of understanding Scripture, namely the issues of Christology. Who is Christ? What is the Trinity? Who is God? He's the one who gave the basic problems, and they're all dealing with those problems that are set by him, but it's because he's given the rule of faith, and the fathers of the church and the councils explain this rule of faith more fully as they develop in Nicaea, Constantinople, and Chalcedon, and the rest of the councils, and the writings of the fathers. And I don't want to omit this sixth stage, which is exegesis, We see origin of Alexandria, going back to that Jewish tradition from Alexandria, beginning to examine the text on their own terms. He does a marvelous job. He's the first scripture scholar in the church. He committed some heresies, otherwise he probably would have been a saint, but he did some errors, like believing in the preexistence of souls. But Origen is the first one to compare the Hebrew text with the Greek manuscripts, and he had three different Greek manuscripts, three different translations. He does the first textual work. He also does the first Christian commentaries on the Bible. But he's also using the Greek philosophy as a way to help him interpret the scriptures. And this continues on, saying Jerome is also an exegete. I love his story because he started to study Hebrew because he was so plagued by sexual temptation. He went from, as a young convert, from a worldly way of life, filled with lots of sexual addiction, we would call it today. He thought maybe moving to Milan where it's cooler, it'll cool my passions. That wasn't cool enough. He moved to Trier. And he tried, that didn't work. Eventually he just studied Hebrew till temptation went away. And then finally the last stage is when Augustine begins to deal with the issue of how do you get saved? And he opens up, what is grace? What is free will? What is salvation? How do I receive it? How does it affect me? This opens up a whole new area. And that would be the final stage that continues on. Well, all of these things continue on to this day. This is how Christian scripture interpretation began. And we're still dealing with many of these struggles. They're great struggles to work with. Some problems that we still have to deal with. We still have Mormons and Muslims writing their own scriptures. We still have to deal with, you know, mistranslations and things like that. We have to deal with those who've lost their faith and don't interpret scripture by faith. But by going back to our roots, perhaps we can help lead a way to interpreting scripture for our own world and help making a better sense out of things. Thank you.